Can we also transmit on SARS?
No, but the pig flu.
You're being filmed, Drew.
What up?
Fired.
Press the
Charles,
press the
you're rehired. I mean, raise.
I'll wait here.
Can you share? Can you share, please? I need some. Oh my goodness.
Right.
We live?
My phone just told me a new video has started. Cool.
You're gonna have to turn off the audio.
All right.
Mute that sucker.
Welcome. Welcome to the very first T-Rex Arms YouTube Live. This is highly experimental. Luke, you're the host.
Yes, I'm the host. We ordered discussing how long we would talk about nothing and wait for people to spool in here. But I'm just going to go ahead and explain what we're doing. So obviously there's a lot of questions people are having in these uncertain times regarding the virus, regarding the economy, regarding morals and principles, which is obviously something a lot of folks are talking about regarding price gouging and then, you know, when it's acceptable to, you know, acquire resources from other people and by what means. There's just a lot of discussion going on by folks, and a lot of people have come to us asking, hey, what is T-Rex Arms thinking about this? You know, what are you guys doing about this? Because there's obviously a lot of talk, and then people also want to know, like, well, what are people doing or how is this affecting them? So we want to take the next 45 minutes to an hour to answer some questions and talk about specifically things that we're taking into consideration and things that we're doing, both as, you know, individuals and also at a company level. T-Rex Arms, you know, we have a lot of employees. Well, not, I mean, it's relative, generally speaking. As
a small company,
as a small company, we have many employees. And so there's just a lot of different things we have to think about in regards to that and, you know, management and then also managing, you know, possible quarantines and different things like that. So that's what we're going to be discussing. So,
and obviously, we're not experts. We're not epidemiologists or virologists. But those of you that are asking questions about what we are doing, those are questions that we can answer.
Yes.
Those of you asking what you should be doing, well.
So,
take what we say with a grain of vitamin C or something.
Yes. So, with that said, so my name is Lucas Botkin. I'm the CEO of T-Rex Arms. Started the company 6 years ago. And here I've got my older brother, Isaac, who is Chief Technical Officer, is the,
something like
head
that.
Of automation.
He handles the CNC department and a bunch of other stuff technologically speaking. And obviously, you guys have seen his videos here on YouTube. In fact, there's one that he just put up 2 days ago regarding constitutional carry bill that's getting pushed through by our own governor here in Tennessee. And then on his right, we have the CFO of T-Rex Arms, David Botkin, who is also an older brother. Yes, we are all brothers. I am actually second youngest. There are six other siblings, seven total, and we've been working together now for years, literally years, and it's been great. So David, obviously, as a CFO, there's a lot of company management that he has to handle that we discuss a lot. Isaac handles a lot of other things, and so this will be an interesting conversation because, you know, I focus on an area over here. Isaac's over here. David's over here. We come together. We all have our own, you know, points and feedback and discussion points. We were actually talking for like
an hour
earlier, and I was like, let's stop talking and save some of this for the live because we're talking about everything.
We've actually been talking about this for some time just because of what are we doing as a family? What are we doing as a community? What are we doing as a company? So this has been an issue. It's been in the news for a while. We've been talking about it for a while, and we've been getting questions about it for a long time.
And we've been following it. I've been following it, I think, for about 6 weeks. It was well before it hit the U.S. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that's transpired during that time frame. The bad news, obviously, is that it's hit America and it's accelerating in its spread. The good news is now that it's in America and in Italy, we have a lot more information than we had when it was just in China or just in China and Iran. And so that's good. There was a lot more speculation about what this thing was and how it worked then than now. But there are still a huge number of unanswered questions. And so this is a very rapidly changing situation, both in terms of our understanding of the virus and in terms of the response by the United States and other governments to this virus. So things that we say now could be significantly different tomorrow.
Yes. Yeah. And one of the interesting things about watching this all transpire is part of the issue is the way that our 24 news cycle works. Part of it is the way that people share information on the internet because they no longer trust any journalists, and I would say
rightfully so.
In most cases. But also the way that the virus itself works, the very, very long incubation period, and then the fact that the data that was originally coming out of China is something that people didn't originally trust. this issue had a lot more misinformation and speculation than we have seen in other issues in the past. And so that has led rise to just a lot of discussion and conspiracy theories and people saying there was completely a hoax, people saying there was the end of the planet, and then everything in between.
There's, right. And it also brings up the interesting point, just due to the amount of social media presence and the explosion and the voices that people have on the internet, is one reason I believe there was a massive toilet paper scare. It would actually be interesting to trace back. What I'm curious about is, you know, which media outlet or what was it that triggered people into thinking that the one item of this, you know, current situation, you know, this is the item that people have to buy. And it was probably like one news site that posted an article, people are taking toilet paper, or it was five people going to one store and cleaning it out that made everyone think this is the item to have, which in reality, like, it's only good if you have food. My trick to not needing toilet paper is don't eat. If you don't eat, you don't need it. So that's what I do. Works pretty well. But what I'm actually interested in is tracing that and figuring out, you know, what was the inciting incident to people going, toilet paper is the commodity of the coronavirus, of this pandemic, when in reality, no, it's not. The virus doesn't even necessarily give you, you know, explosive diarrhea. But for whatever reason, people are like, oh, toilet paper.
Apparently, so, this may not be true, but Derek read somewhere that there are major, major toilet paper factories in Wuhan. And so when people heard that Wuhan was shutting down, they started posting that toilet paper is going to be scarce, go buy some.
Oh, interesting.
But as soon as the media started covering the toilet paper run,
they changed it a little bit and said toilet paper is now gone instead, and everyone's...
And that kind of, that brings up a topic that we wanted to cover, which is kind of the fragility of the modern global supply chain system and the way that modern American companies run their inventory.
Yeah. I was going to do that down closer to the bottom.
Yeah.
Why don't we start off with what probably the big question that everyone has, which is this virus and everything that's going on around it a big deal or not?
And on a scale of 1 to 10.
On a scale of 1 to 10, the virus is a...
Somewhere between 1 and 10. Well, probably somewhere between 2 and 9.
The flu being a 1 and bubonic plague being a 10, I would put this at a 3.
Well, now here's the issue.
Right.
The issue is that the virus in and of itself is only one part of the puzzle. The way that people respond to the virus could very easily push this into a catastrophic situation.
Yeah. Yes.
Or it could be handled really well, and it's going to be somewhere in the middle.
Yeah. Right. So so some of the basic facts about this disease are there's a lot of misinformation or confusion about the deadliness of this disease. There's a ton of people that this keeps coming up. Well, it's only killed this many people in America. Every year, flu season kills this many. This is really not that big a deal. I liken that line of thinking to something along the lines of, well, nukes haven't killed anybody in a really long time. You know, no one has died from a nuclear weapon in the last 50 years, so clearly it's not a big deal. And the issue is not the total number of deaths or the recentness of the deaths. It's the potential to cause death. Mm-hmm. And with this disease, we have two factors. Well, I'll say three. So the first factor is the ease of transmission that this disease has. It transmits very easily. There's still debate over whether it's truly airborne or droplet, and there's some technical differences there in terminology that I don't fully understand. Basically, how small can the droplets be, as I understand it? So there's some stuff there that's not fully understood. But most recently, there was a great interview on the Joe Rogan Show. Yeah. And that doctor was saying, and I've heard other doctors saying this recently as well, it can be transmitted not just by coughing, but by just breathing. The viral particles go into those vapor droplets or whatever, and it goes out. And so just breathing is enough to infect people.
But generally within close proximity or closer, possibly.
Close-ish. I don't know.
Could probably depend on winds,
how far does your breath vapor go? I mean, if you eat garlic and you go into a room, how long does it take before everyone smells the garlic?
I smell it immediately. 50 meters.
That's kind of the potential issue. And like, I'm not saying the virus is garlic or vice versa. I'm just saying
it could be very serious.
This is a component that I don't understand and we should take seriously. So transmits very easily. And it's able to reproduce itself in people and become infectious again very quickly. And so the official number is that the number of people with cases will double or triple just in a few days. Mm-hmm. And then the third component is the mortality rate on this disease. The mortality rate or the case fatality rate is actually not that high. I mean, it's high enough. It's higher than a lot of diseases. It's somewhere in the vicinity probably of about 1%. The Diamond Princess ship is very interesting because they had a large number of people that got it, but they all got top-tier medical attention right off the bat. I think they're at around 1%. I actually haven't checked in a couple days. 1% fatality rate. Now, not everyone's completely recovered yet, so it could go up a little bit. But in Wuhan, we saw something more like, assuming their numbers are correct on how many people got it, something more like a 5% mortality rate. Now, other areas in China got more like a 1% mortality rate. So the question is, which is it? And the answer, I think we can understand by looking at what's happening in Italy.
Yeah.
About 10 days ago, reports started coming out of Italy that the hospitals were having to do triage on their patients. So patient comes in, 70 years old, and that patient is not going to get top-tier treatment because there's a finite number of breathing machines. Mm-hmm. And so when a 30-year-old has serious symptoms and a 70-year-old has serious symptoms, they give the breathing machine to the one with a better likelihood of a good outcome. And the 70-year-old that would have been a winnable case if they'd had the resources now is not a winnable case.
Yeah.
And so as the medical establishment, the medical industry, whatever, gets overloaded, you're going to probably see, based on the Italy experience, a higher fatality rate. You also see a lot of fatalities in Italy because Italy has the second highest aging population in the world. Mm-hmm. People over 65 is the metric. And Japan is number one, and Italy is number two. America is not even on the top 10 list. So we probably will not have the same overall mortality rate that Italy will for that reason.
Yeah.
However, 1% is still a big deal if you're talking about a disease that can spread very rapidly. And young people are not very affected. As a general rule,
but there is still
this is something that's important to take into consideration. So let's say the virus is really only lethal to people 60 and older, or people with massive underlying health conditions. The responsibility on us as young people, because like I'm not concerned about getting it and me having issues, or David's not, Isaac's not. But the thing that we have to consider as young dudes running around doing stuff is I could get it. And then potentially give it to someone who then dies or doesn't fare so well. So me being a young person, I could probably run all around, downtown Nashville and, downtown Franklin and just do whatever like I normally do, except a lot of places are now closed. And then go back to work, go see my family or do whatever. And then I could get, one of my employees sick, or they could go home and give their grandmother this.
Yeah.
And now I've basically been the transmission means for this virus to go to someone who is actually going to be harmed by it. So it's, I believe, and we believe as well, that it's on us as, younger dudes and, just young people in general, that we have to take responsibility and we can't just, run around, do what we normally do, negligently, and then potentially affect other people, or also affect the medical system, as David talked about, where there's more people in the hospitals using up the supplies, using up the stuff, or using up potentially a vaccine when or if one is discovered. Maybe it's really hard to make, or it's really expensive, so people are just going in there and using it all up, and then people that actually really need it die. We don't want to overload the system for no reason. Absolutely not. So that's a big thing, a takeaway for young folks. Like, will it affect us? Probably not. We don't know yet exactly, but probably not.
The China numbers say that,
but
it's like 0.2% for someone in my age bracket. Now, that's like 1 in 500 people dying. That's not insignificant.
Yeah. If you had a bag of Skittles and one of them would kill you, would you still eat the bag?
No.
Would you take one out and eat one?
No. So I would throw those Skittles away.
Yeah.
So Luke touches on a great point. Our company is all about people taking responsibility to protect others. Mm-hmm. And this is totally a way to do that. And people might say, well, but my rights, but my freedom, I should be able to go wherever I want and do whatever I want. And I remember early on in this thing, when it was just first hitting America and the airlines were just starting to reel, there were these articles coming out about these millennials. They're like, well, it's not going to hurt me. Cheap airfare, I'm going to travel. And I saw this one article about a woman, and she was going to travel from, I think it was the Bay Area, to New York, to Washington, and Canada. It was like she was picking the hot spot. It was almost like she was picking the
hot
spots.
She wanted to catch it.
She was trying. It was almost like, I don't think this was her intent, to be a human petri dish, to collect all the strains, mix them together, create the super virus, and spread it. I saw another person posting like, airfares are cheap. I know there's this virus out there, but I just got to go see my grams. And I was just like, the millennials, like, the quote that came to mind is like, I am death. I have become death, destroyer of worlds. They're like, yeah. That is what they're doing. These people are being very selfish. So we can't just be like, I should be able to do whatever I want. No. You know, if you see a mass shooter gunning people down, you might say, well, I don't have to put my life on the line for those people. But we would argue, yes, you do. You have a moral responsibility. Your freedom to hide and run away, yes, that's, you may have the freedom to do that.
Doesn't necessarily make it right.
But it doesn't make it ethical.
Yeah.
It doesn't make it the righteous move. And so we say, take responsibility, be careful. This is a big deal. It's not, you know, there's people that are acting like the world is ending. And the answer is no, it's not. We've seen pandemics with much higher fatality rates in the past, and we're all still around today. It didn't kill off all of mankind.
Now, there are some differences, though, to the situation that we find ourselves in now, and even the last big pandemic in 1918, or the Black Death. And one of those things is that the world that we live in is far more interconnected. There's a lot more dependencies over a wider geographic area. So that kind of brings us to the economic impact.
There's a lot more travel.
There's a lot more travel, so things spread faster. But there's also just a lot more dependencies on stuff. So, for example, let's go back to the Black Death. It wiped out a third of Europe. You could have lost all of the farmers in an entire geographic region. They could all be dead. But that doesn't actually affect people on the other side of the country. They can still produce food. Here, though, it's a little bit harder to do that. Our power grid, for example, is incredibly interconnected. So if we lost a whole bunch of workers, guys who are part of the utilities out on the West Coast, we're going to feel that as far east as Tennessee.
Right.
Texas has its own power grid, interestingly enough, but they're the only ones that have that are separate and decentralized here in the state. So there's a lot more interconnectedness. And that's why massive disease issues on the other side of the planet are going to affect what food is available in your supermarket today. It's kind of a new level of dependency.
Yeah, and not just food, but consumer goods.
Yeah.
And this is something that we mostly deal in American-made products, and we mostly deal in American raw goods, but we have a few things that come from China. And so far, we're not impacted because we keep those things in many months' supply. And so if there's a disruption, we're not suddenly completely shut down. And like that's kind of what we're seeing at the national level. There's this frenzy over masks because people aren't able to get them because a lot of them come from China. And if China is just completely shut down, ground to a halt, and there's a debate over whether that is still going on or whether everyone's back to work or what, you get officially everyone's back or many people are back to work. Unofficially, people are saying, yes, the factories are on, the lights are running, the machinery is running, but there's no people there. The factories are just turning on all the equipment to make the power usage look like they're operating so the Chinese government can report that they're back in operation. So we're hearing different things. We don't know what the truth is. I don't trust the Chinese government very far. So
we're going to have to find out a lot of this stuff as we go. At this point, like a lot of things, it's too early to tell and put an exact price tag, body count, disruption rate on any of this, but it's good to be thinking through all these things.
Let's move into what we're doing. So obviously, we've kind of laid the groundwork for, you know, the way we're looking at this sort of event that is taking place that is, I believe, historical. I think we all do.
Right.
What are some things that, you know, we are doing either as individuals? Obviously, we talked about some of the personal responsibility regarding going out in public. Right now, I'm only going to the range, which is it's our own range. So I'm not running into a bunch of folks. And then, you know, here at our shop facility and then obviously where I live. And that's it. Not going anywhere else. I don't need to. Not going on any trips. I don't have to for what I'm doing. What are some other things that we are doing either as a company or just what you guys are doing as far as dealing with this?
So part of what's driving what we're doing is our understanding of what's happening in the U.S. So we see new policies coming out almost daily. And what's happening is the state and federal and local governments are trying to get a handle on what's going on and what appropriate measures to counter the spread of this virus are. And so you have these social distancing laws, like shutting down bars and shutting down schools and restaurants and things like that. And at this point, it's all being done very much in a haphazard manner. You have the lockdown thing from the president, which is really just a set of recommendations. You know, there's no enforcement action taken there yet, as far as I'm aware. You know, have Maryland, in some areas in Maryland, they're starting to have enforcement action. Like, you have to, you can't just go do stuff. These are not recommendations anymore. Nashville closed all their bars. There's bars that are saying this is unconstitutional. We're going to stay open anyway. So there's a lot of stuff that's changing. And basically the only thing that we can predict, I can kind of make two predictions. Number one, I think that shutting down the economy, like no one can go to work, is going to be a pretty last possibility.
Yeah,
I think that they're going to really do everything they can not to do that. And the lockdowns in Italy and Spain, at least, as far as I'm aware, they said like total lockdown. Well, you could still go to work. You could still go to the pharmacy.
That's not a total lockdown.
There were, right. In China, the total lockdown is we're going to weld you in your apartment.
Yeah, and that's more of a lockdown.
We will come by and we will drop food off.
Maybe.
Maybe. I saw a horrible thing where they had a garbage truck dumping out chunks of meat to distribute. And
because, was it bat meat?
No, it was pig meat.
Too soon.
It was pig meat.
Man.
So,
it's brutal.
So we can, I do not expect, and maybe I'm being naive or hopeful, but I'm not expecting like a total lockdown. Like, you may not leave your home. No one may leave their home. There's too, as I see it, there's too much critical infrastructure. Now, that said, since this disease disproportionately affects older people, since our government is run almost exclusively by older people, it could be that they react irrationally or out of selfish interest to protect themselves. And
we've seen some government institutions like schools do that already.
Well, and I wonder, like, Trump was very, you know, not a big deal, it's a hoax, that kind of language, and then boom, just like that, state of emergency. And in between those two events, he was potentially exposed to the disease. So I don't know if he suddenly, like, it was a personal thing for him, or I don't wish to speculate, but it is interesting that he changed rapidly. We could see this happen.
So yeah. So with that said, what are some things? What are we doing?
So on Monday, everything is moving so fast.
Yes.
We rolled out some new policy. We've been notifying our employees about this for probably the last month. Just kind of keeping them updated, giving them some recommendations on different stuff to do. And so I'm just going to kind of roll through some of these policy points. So we rolled out a sick policy. If people are sick, they cannot come to work. If they become sick at work, they have to go home. Actually, you all are hearing this, and a lot of our employees haven't heard this yet. We ordered one of those forehead thermometers. It's a non-touch one. So we'll test people's temperature when they come in to see if they have the fever. A fever is the predominant symptom for this disease. So if they have a fever, they can't come to work. And then if they have the symptoms of COVID-19, if possible, they'll need to get a negative test before they can come back to work.
And that's something we're still trying to figure out how to do. And by the way, contrary to what you're reading on the internet, it is not private industry's fault that there's not good testing. It's the FDA's fault. It's the government's
and the CDC.
Fault. And the CDC. It's government agencies that are causing problems here. It's not capitalism.
I remember.
It's government regulation.
It was like, I think it was about 10 days ago, I read an article by a laboratory. And almost every state, I think at that time there were 6 states that could not do the test. All the others could do the test. One state lab was saying, yeah, we can do over 1,000 tests a day. So if that's the same number for every, you know, that's like 50,000 tests a day. We're not doing 50,000 tests a day. There was 1 week where the CDC, just like 2 weeks ago, they tested like 150 people. For some reason, and I have various theories on this, they are not testing. They're either being the biggest ostriches with their heads in the sand, or there's something more clever or duplicitous happening. And I don't know.
So with all that said, so I am curious. Sure, so I haven't had to go in public, except for, I guess, here, since, like, over the weekend and stuff.
Yeah.
And I have really no intention of really going anywhere. If you guys are going into public, because this is something a lot of people are wondering, is, you know, should I wear a mask? I saw some people when I was at Costco last week I saw one guy wearing a mask. Most people weren't. Most people just didn't care. What are some things, you know, or things people need to consider if they do have to go into public? Let's say, for example, there is more of a shutdown, or a lot of places are self-shutting down, like restaurants, because people aren't coming in. And if you don't have customers, you close down. A lot of places are having to self-close down. Dentists are closing down. So my question is, if there's a lockdown or things keep going the way it is, grocery stores most likely will stay open. So people will have to occasionally go to the grocery store or go to the gas station to get fill up their vehicle.
Sure.
What, and people are wondering, well, do you have to wear gloves? Do you have to wear a mask? What
in the last?
What stuff people should do?
So
what's wrong with this mask?
Actually, well, do you mean this specific one or well, in general?
In general, one of the ways that the virus travels in droplets is just through the air, and it can get into your mucous membranes, which includes your eyes. So a mask like that that's not covering your eyes,
and that's one of these,
is better
still
than nothing. But if you want to be fully protected,
so that doctor on the Rogan show, he was saying that they still don't know, but a mask may reduce your chance of getting it by 5 times, just by
covering
your mouth. Now the mucous membranes thing is a big deal. This is definitely the true with certain other viruses, and this one's still somewhat unknown, but the eyes are a way to enter, the nose is a way to enter, so covering up your mouth and nose is great, but you still have your eyes. And that's actually personally why I like a mask like this.
Are you recommending that everybody wear masks all the time?
I mean, I wear this when I go into town.
If I had to go to Franklin, I would probably wear something like this. And
it kind of depends on what you're doing. At this point, so I have elderly neighbors that I have been talking to about what they're planning, what they're wanting to do, ways that we can help them. And when I go over and talk to them in the future, I will probably start wearing a mask, but it'll be for their protection.
Right. These masks, everything on this table does not protect other people. So those surgical masks, those little rectangles with little loops that go around your ears or whatever, those are to protect other people from the doctor. So like he's working on someone and he doesn't want to cough and put his mucus onto the patient's open wound or whatever. So that's to protect other people. That doesn't really protect you very much at all from floating viral.
And that's what the issue with
these. The issue with these are you breathe in through the filter, but there's
when
a
you
valve,
breathe out and you have all of your vapor exiting the mask.
So basically, if you're sick and you have it, you just have
to stay at home. Right.
And just not go anywhere. Stay put for, they're recommending 2 weeks is what it looks like. If you do have it, is that what they're saying? If you're tested positive or you really think you have it.
So originally when people were getting it, they were locking them down and quarantining them, and they could not leave. The quarantine was not over until the person had 2 negative tests. Test them. This one came up negative. A couple days later or whatever, take another test.
Is it like a polygraph that you can lie through? It's kind of like that.
I don't know, but
there've
been some cases where people had it, tested negative, and then died afterwards. Mm. And they don't know if they became reinfected. Some people on the internet are like, oh no, it can reinfect you. And I am skeptical about that because a lot of people I've read that seem to know their stuff are skeptical also, because that doesn't seem like that goes against everything we know about how viruses work and antibodies work.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, let's get back on track to stuff that we're doing.
Right. Okay.
At this point, nobody knows this stuff. Talking about what we don't know about the virus will just make this long and boring because nobody knows much about that.
Right.
But one of the things that I think is really important, trying to take care of other people is necessary. Mm-hmm. You can't just be a lone wolf. And there's too many people on the internet, even in the comment section right here, talking about how it doesn't matter to me. Hopefully the boomer remover actually does its job and there's only us left and then everything will be better. Mm-hmm. And that is not only a terrible, but also idiotic position to hold. The infrastructure is largely run by people who are older and smarter than you, especially if that's the way that you comment on
facts.
But the other issue is that we should be prepared for this sort of thing all the time, both personally and as companies. The virus and the reaction to the virus, at this point more than the virus, is revealing a lot of weaknesses in the way that we think about stuff, the way that we talk about stuff, the way that we do business, and the way that we live. So one of the weaknesses that we have is it's really easy for us to run out of stuff because we don't prepare for things personally, and businesses are running out of stuff because they're not prepared for stuff either. Our infrastructure is run on razor-thin margins. That doesn't mean that businesses
supply
don't
margins,
make profit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Supply margins are usually razor thin. Just-in-time inventory is how everybody wants to do business because it's maximum efficiency.
Yeah.
Kind of in the same way that if you don't have a spare tire in your car, you get better gas mileage. So it's more efficient for you to not have a jack and a spare tire. But if you ever need a jack and a spare tire, now you're stranded by the side of the road until one comes.
Right.
Having these insurance policies in place is always expensive at some level, but it pays off in other areas. And lots of companies, lots of institutions, lots of infrastructure doesn't do that. And a lot of people don't do that. So one of the things that's kind of interesting is now people are panic buying food. Food was so much cheaper, so much more available earlier. And one of the things that my wife and I try to do is keep a lot of bulk food around. And so when this happened, we weren't put in a place where we had to strain our finances by getting expensive food. It was something we were already trying to do. And instead of buying MREs that are, well, a few weeks ago, they were 10 bucks a meal to buy the fancy ones that heat themselves.
Or even that freeze-dried survival food, which everything I've ever tasted is very horrible.
Yeah. People love to talk about military spec. People who love the idea of military spec have never eaten military spec food.
Or shot military spec guns.
But if you can keep on hand the stuff that you regularly use, like regular peanut butter, regular beans, regular rice, if you can buy those things in bulk and have those around, you actually use them. You actually save money by buying them bulk in the first place. And then if something like this happens, you're not caught out in the rain. So that is something that we have tried to do as a family just in general.
Right.
And there's times when it saves us money because food prices change. There's times when it saves us money because something like this happens and food prices change a lot. So that's the way I think that all of us should be thinking about things in the future. As the world gets more interconnected and more fragile, there's a lot more possibility for disruptions. And so as a company, we're trying to have more hardware on stock. We're trying to have more inventory here. Even though technically it's expensive and less efficient, it helps us and it helps you. And then we're also doing that personally in ways that we can.
Like we've had a lot of armor in stock for the past... what, 5 months?
No.
4 months?
No, it was...
it's been a little while.
It's been about three.
About three months.
It really started turning into a stockpile.
It started turning into a potential problem because that's money that's sitting and not necessarily going out the door. But what we've seen is people now have a way to get armor if they didn't get armor before this is happening. And now we're selling through it and it's great. We're not, you know, obviously we're not jacking the prices up. That's a whole nother conversation. But it is something that's interesting, kind of like what Isaac talked about. Companies, you know, they keep two of something in stock, and as soon as one of it sells, they order another one. And that works when everything is perfect. It works when the economy's fine, when nobody's rushing to get anything. But as soon as there's a, you know, a panic or a crisis, and I will say, so I'm a silver lining person. I love the silver lining to things, even when things are not so great. But one of the silver linings to this particular situation we have is this could be a lot worse. Now, it could also get a lot worse. But what I'm really...
And we should expect...
We should expect that it will get worse.
It's almost...
Yeah.
Certainly going to. Like, the death toll, just to go back slightly, the death toll, most people, I think, are on respirators for about 3 weeks before they die.
Right.
So there is a long lag between a bunch of cases and a death toll.
And so people are saying only so many people have died.
And that's why suddenly that Italy has 400 people die in one day. Because, you know, it took a while for people to get to that point.
And kind of what I'm getting at is, like, obviously this virus could be a lot worse. It could be transmitted through the air exponentially more than it currently is, although it could always get worse. But I hope people are, you know, taking what's happening and they're going to use that, you know, once the system comes back, hopefully it will, and we'll start being more prepared. Because most people, they, you know, since, I think it was Sandy Hook is when the PMags went up to like $90 a magazine. And people, you know, they freaked out then. They were going and trying to find those magazines. But then it's like, PMags had been, you know, they were $10 before then. There was no reason you couldn't have stocked up beforehand. The same thing with ammo. Right now, there's obviously all the ammo's gone. But a month ago, you could buy ammo for 27 cents a round for 5.56 for brass cased. Like, there was nothing stopping you from being prepared or even a little bit prepared. Right. And a lot of the people complaining right now, they're complaining because they didn't get prepared. They were, you know, using their money in other stuff. They were prioritizing other things because that is what people do. Whether you're prioritizing what you want, or you're, you know, prioritizing, you know, the things that make you happy. And then when something like this happens and you go, oh man, I really shouldn't have gone to a lot of bars and blown all my money drinking. I really should have bought some ammo to have, even if it's just 1,000 rounds. Right. And that's ultimately what we all need to be doing more of when we're in a time of plenty, when there's, you know, lots of ammo, when there's, you know, the ammo's inexpensive, when I can actually buy toilet paper and maybe have a month's supply, which I've never thought about that until, I guess, this thing. Have some toilet paper that can last. I still have some. Well, but, you know, those are things that I'm hoping people will learn from the situation to be even more prepared. Because next time, if there is a next time, which I'm sure there'll be a next time, it could be way worse. It could be a World War III situation. I mean, right now, and I saw people, this is the other interesting thing. They were complaining about the fact they may have to stay home for 2 weeks, and rightfully so for some folks. But if you still have power and you still have the internet and you're home for 2 weeks, there is so much stuff that you can do. Provided you have food, of course, to live and water for 2 weeks. But
not just a mountain of toilet paper.
You can study all kinds of things in that two-week time period if you have the internet. And right now we have, at least where we are in Tennessee right now, we have all of our utilities. We've got running water. We've got electricity. We've got internet. If I have to stay home in my house for 2 weeks because I get infected, you know, I could just mope around and watch TV all day and, you know, watch Netflix and all that. Or, you know, play the new Call of Duty, which I'm sure I would because it's awesome. But what I would also do is I would try to study as much as I can because I've still got the internet. I've still got power, at least hopefully. And I just find it really interesting how much millennials are complaining about their lack of preparedness ahead of time.
Right.
And the fact they may have to be forced to stay home with basically all of their utilities and their internet and their power. Granted, they have enough food and water and to live.
So the prepper discussion or argument or whatever you want to call it is interesting because some people view preppers as some sort of like, you know, you're going to get on a government list if you're a prepper and stuff like that. And it's interesting because I had it out there on a table. I don't know where it went. But I have a big FEMA guide, and it's all about preparedness.
It's all about prepping.
It's all about prepping. And it says, you know, here's what you should have. There's no guns in it.
Sad omission, but...
Very major sad omission.
Yeah, we can add that ourselves.
But it covers tornadoes, floods. It also covers radiological events, like nuclear terrorism. It covers all kinds of stuff in there. And it says, you know, you should have this much food. I think they say 2 weeks. And the fact of the matter is, it really doesn't cost. I think some people may think, oh, I can't afford to prep with food. I can't buy all this special stuff. And it's like, no, it's not special stuff. All you're doing is time shifting your spending. If you spend $500 a month on food, but you just buy a little extra and purchase that stuff in advance, what it means is that you've tied up some of your capital in assets and not in Federal Reserve notes and money.
It requires discipline.
Which requires discipline, but now it means if you have any disruption in your money, you actually have this buffer of food.
And this is one of the things that I think, like I said, the biggest issue that we're seeing weaknesses being revealed.
Right.
And this is going to be the silver lining, is like I said, is when weaknesses are revealed, then we can fix them. And hopefully people actually take this course. But talking about this issue, one of the reasons I think that this virus has the potential to disrupt a lot of things is because so many individuals do the opposite of what you're talking about.
Right.
Instead of being just a few weeks ahead food-wise, they're right up on the cutting edge of exactly what they can get away with their payroll. They're living payroll to payroll with no margin whatsoever.
And there's
I know
a lot
of people like that.
And they spend a lot on luxuries that are non-essential. And you know what? I don't mind if people do that. But when they run on a razor-thin margin, it's like these companies, they frustrate me so much. They run on a razor-thin supply margin. And then when the economy gets disrupted, their business model is severely harmed, and then they go running and crying to the government,
and
saying,
they lay a bunch of people off,
and then they say, oh, we need all these handouts because we are suffering financially. And then people like us that took precautions ahead of time, you know, I was planning for economic disruption this year, at the end of last year, and so we had months of raw goods supply on hand, with a few exceptions because the supplier messed up an order. And so we're able to keep going. If we can't get anything from China, we're going to be able to keep going for months. But we will be the ones that foot the bill because that other company ran on razor thin supply margins to make more money. And now they need a bailout. Yeah. And it's the exact same thing with people. They do the exact same thing.
And the other thing is, it's not loving to their employees when you have a company that runs on these margins, because they end up having to essentially fire everyone if they're not able to get product and ship it out and hire those people. So now they're affecting the livelihoods of who knows how many people they're having to lay off. And that's a whole other issue that you're having to deal with.
And so,
we see these weaknesses revealed as soon as there's this much of a hiccup.
Right. And so it was interesting. I had a conversation with my daughter. So like 6 weeks ago or something, I can't remember, we saw this thing happening, or we saw this thing coming. And so we went to Costco and we stocked up. And this was before any of the panic buying. And I was talking to my daughter about it. And she was saying, isn't it selfish for us to go and buy all this food? And I said, no, it's not, because there's plenty of food right now. Nobody is buying. And all we were doing was just like, we normally buy two things of olives. We buy a few extra things of olives. We just go a little deeper
on
like supplies.
A pallet of olives.
No,
wasn't like that.
Nothing crazy.
That might be foolish.
I said, actually, this is very good because there's plenty of food now. And when everyone is panicking, I don't have to buy anything. So I was actually in a store getting some hydrogen peroxide the other day, and I saw toilet paper on the shelf, and I did not buy any. The reason is I have all.
You're a hero.
I am a hero. I have all I need. I don't need to take from the supply chain. I have a reserve, so I don't need to depend on an already fragile system. And if more people had that, there could be disruptions. Like, hey, it's fine. So I don't need anything right now. I'm good. I'm good for a while. If more people live that way, we'd have a lot fewer of these panic buying type situations. Ditto for ammo. It takes some self-control, but like if you're good on some supply, if you have ammo, it might be good to not buy right now. Yeah. Because there's people that don't have ammo. I've had a number of people approach me like, yeah, I don't have any ammo. I have like one box. And so I'm like, you know what? I can help you out here. But ideally, nobody gets into that position. They have their monthly amount they use, and then they just have multiple months of that. And it just requires that you just time shift your spending, just like people started time shifting their viewing.
That's the way that you, I think, yeah, everybody needs to be thinking.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's so much dependence going on. So we're getting a lot of comments. I can't even keep track with all these things.
Yeah, so I'll just hit a couple more policy points real fast. Yeah. So we had a sick policy. We banned visitors from our company with a few exceptions, like the spouses of employees can still come here and stuff.
They're probably already
trying to limit the amount of people coming in and out. Because obviously, contact. If we have a bunch of people that get quarantined, that's going to affect us shipping product out to you guys. And I will say that right now, everything's running how it normally is. We're still shipping stuff out. Probably the biggest two factors that would affect our company right now would be Postal Service is like, okay, we don't have enough people. A bunch of our people are quarantined. We're not coming to pick up packages. We're not shipping. Or a lot of our staff get, affected and they have to stay home for 2 weeks. And so now you guys can't get your orders. Those are the two big factors.
Yeah. We also strongly recommended people not go into crowded public spaces, not travel on airlines.
We're not exactly telling people what to do. Like, no one's fired if they do this, but we're trying to help you guys. We're trying to help you guys get the products that you order.
Right.
And we're trying to be as accommodating to you as we can. And that means asking our employees to do more to help you guys out.
We have a number of people also of our employees that do admin type work, and we're able to send them home to work from home. So we've done that. And another thing we did is we actually gave a bonus to everybody. Like, we might say we take this seriously, and some employees might say, I'm not sure if you're right on this, but we figure if we give someone a bonus to go try to get a week or two of food in their pantry, that's a pretty strong way of saying we take this seriously, we care about you.
Which is very different, I might add, than a government bailout, because this is a private company that is helping their employees, and it's not the government just sending money to people. That's a whole other discussion, of course.
So,
and this is something that other companies should think about. There are companies, obviously, there are companies that are doing better this week than they were a couple of weeks ago. T.REX is probably one of those companies. People selling ammo, people selling guns, people selling tactical stuff. The internet is desperate to buy guns. Even liberals who think that the gun show loophole a thing and that they can just buy things over the internet, they've heard that it's easier to buy a gun than books. They are shockingly disappointed this week.
It has to. What's an FFL?
So some companies are doing better this week, and we're wanting to try to help our employees out. And that's something that other companies can be doing. That's part of the silver lining, is we're seeing some weaknesses now, but also ways to fix those weaknesses now before, before things get real bad. We would like to try to help with that. Yeah. So
were there any other policy points?
We did some stuff like,
There's a big one.
Extended our lead times just because we can't,
we don't know what's going to happen.
We can't predict things.
Like, if we get 1,000 orders tomorrow more than normal, then we may not be able to meet the lead times that we promised you.
Yeah. If half of our employees are out because they're in 2 weeks of quarantine again,
or all, like if we discover that Luke had it and he went and spread it around the company to everybody, like we would all,
I'm not wearing this enough. Oh wait, that doesn't work.
That wouldn't work. We'd have to make everyone else wear that.
May as well.
We can't afford those for everybody.
I guess we will next year.
Once
everything comes back.
These will be fine.
So there is a big elephant in the room because everybody's talking about it. Cheaper than dirt, price gouging, which happens. Price gouging always happens. That's the term people use for an item, supply, or whatever dries up. Item now becomes very expensive. Sandy Hook, obviously magazines, they've been talking about magazine ban. All three round magazines started to go out of stock everywhere. Cheaper Than Dirt bumped the price from that normal like $12 up to like 80 something, 90 something dollars.
Yeah.
And so a lot of people, there's obviously companies that are doing this right now, mainly with ammunition. And this is, you know, a lot of people are very perturbed that companies such as Cheaper Than Dirt and others as well are raising their prices so much. Many people, of course, don't understand how simple economics work with supply and demand, shortages and cost of goods, different things like that. But I guess the question that people have is, you know, one that I've seen at least is people going, well, the government needs to come in and they need to regulate this and prevent this sort of thing from happening. And the funny part is, some of the people saying this are the same people that say, I don't want the government involved with anything with my life. Ooh, but I want the government to come in and help me buy my ammo that I didn't buy a month ago when I should have been a little more disciplined in my spending and buying ahead of time. So really interesting, the inconsistencies that we've seen so far.
And we had like a half hour conversation on this, you know, debating pros and cons and problems. And like if there is a rush on Tickle Me Elmo and there's people trying to con those off at $1,000 a pop, I couldn't care less.
Interestingly enough, we're about to see some shortages in the American economy.
Yes.
There are people who have never seen a shortage since Tickle Me Elmo. Now, gun owners
or Nintendo Wii.
Well, I guess there was that one. But gun owners have seen some shortages. We're one of the few demographics that have actually seen shortages
Chronic
in recent
shortages.
Years. And so this is an interesting thing to talk about. You mentioned Cheaper Than Dirt, but...
Yeah. They're one famous of the, for this.
They're famous for this. And there's a couple reasons why I don't want to do business with them, and I think that they're problematic. But adjusting the cost of goods based on the supply and the demand is not necessarily wrong in itself. One of the underlying principles of capitalism is that a thing is worth what people are willing to pay for it. So several weeks ago, and there are types of ammunition that were worth a lot less than they are now because they were very plentiful. They are now scarce commodities, which means they're worth more, which means that people will charge more for them. Demanding that the prices never change is like saying that gold should cost exactly as much as iron, even though gold is very scarce and iron is very plentiful. Demanding that they be the same just because they're both metal is kind of what some people are doing on the internet, and demanding that the government fix the prices it's problematic. It's a Bernie Sanders move.
Right, and so, you know, I kind of look at it from a slightly different perspective. You know, if there's something that is necessary for life, like the example I used was the power is out, a gas station has gas, I have a generator, I need it to run a CPAP machine for someone so they don't die, and I go to get gas and the guy was like, oh yeah, my gas is $50 a gallon now. He's behaving in an incredibly unloving way. Now I have very mixed feelings about the price gouging laws, however, and I'm not justifying them. It's just, of all the laws that the government has on the books, these are potentially some of the least bad. I mean, they do so many other horrible things. They're at least trying to prevent basically people taking extreme advantage or oppressing the poor, who maybe they didn't have any ability to buy
stock
more, to stock up in advance.
Yeah. Now, there is a free
maybe
market
their
solution
house,
for this.
Maybe their house got flooded and then all their preps got washed away.
Yeah.
All their toilet paper turned soggy. And now, you know, like, there's these things. And the biblical principle is we're supposed to love one another, to do unto each other as we would have them do unto us. But just because that's a biblical command doesn't mean the government should step in and enforce, no, you must love your neighbor.
Yeah.
Herein lies the problem, because we see people behaving in an incredibly selfish, exploitive way, and we see the government trying to fix said selfish, exploitive behavior, and it's just kind of a mess. And so...
Mm-hmm. It's a complicated situation. There are a lot of factors here. One way that this problem can solve itself is that when you have a company that is exploiting people, that is oppressing people with prices because they can get away with it. Well, after the disaster is over, after the supplies come back, you don't have to deal with those people anymore.
Right.
That's the way that the free market handles it. But I do agree that there could be situations in which an entire community comes together, goes to the owner of the gas station and says, hey, listen, you know that Joe doesn't have the money for this. You know that the gas isn't actually worth this much. It's only worth this much to Joe because this is the only way that he can keep his grandmother alive. We're going to help take care of Joe, and we want you to pitch in, or
or when this is
over. Or when this is over, we're done with your store forever. And that's why community relationships are very important, right. Even in a pandemic that gets spread.
Well, and there's community. And there's another factor, too, that I think a lot of people are overlooking is when they are in a situation, let's say, with the ammo, right? So right now, on a particular website, cheaper than dirt, there's like Lake City, 55 grand, 556 for $900 for 1,000, unless the price has changed today. Now the spot price is different, but or whatever. And, you know, so people are obviously complaining about that because they didn't stock up ahead of time. But maybe, let us say, you absolutely needed the ammo. It might mean you need to sell your gold platinum Xbox to buy that ammo for $900. Right. And that's something a lot of people really want to avoid, is getting rid of their luxuries or the things that they hold dear. But it is possible in some of these situations that is just what you're going to have to do. Like maybe right. that gas is $50. You may have to sell this thing right. that is really nice, but you don't really need because the gas is actually more important. And essentially yeah. pay up. Like that may be a thing. And you may have to sell your jet ski or your really nice luxury item that you don't necessarily really need, your water car, but get rid of that so that you can actually buy the thing that you absolutely need. And yes, I just said that.
And the other thing is, we sometimes get spoiled. We're used to a certain commodity being yes. a certain price, and sometimes the price can change, and it's not price gouging. Like filters, you know, I'm assuming this filter got made in China. If we can't get them from China and we have to make them in America, it could be five times the price. Not yep. because the 3M is ripping people off, but because American labor is so much more expensive and American materials are so much more expensive.
Yep.
That's the thing. I mean, that's why our holsters cost more than a Chinese holster. You're paying for American labor and American quality made here, and it's different. And if you don't like our prices, you can go buy a Pakistani holster yep. and fund... The
yeah, hey Charles, cartels, hey Charles, or... how much did I know you're like, whoa. Remember when everyone was Bitcoin mining and the graphics cards went up? How much did those go up, or they disappeared at least and they went up in yes. price some?
I forget the percentages, but they're back down to normal,
right?
They
were now they're like back down to normal.
A $600 graphics card was 12 or 15.
Yeah, so they
so stuff was doubling and then
yeah.
And then, well, and there and was the same thing happened with the Thailand flood, because a mm-hmm. third of the hard drives in the world got made in Thailand. So when there was that big flood, what, 10 years ago or something, the world realized we're about to have a chronic shortage on spinning disk drives.
And there was a run on every single store.
And the yeah. price went up. The price went up because the ability to produce dramatically went down. With a lot of the goods that are being price gouged, there may not be a reduction in capacity to manufacture. Now, there may be a reduction of ammo coming from Europe. We get a lot of our ammo from Eastern Europe. But the American ammo, there shouldn't really be a reason for that stuff mm-hmm. to cost more yeah, today no. than
so,
it did
so
yesterday.
So, obviously, we gotta close out here in a
pretty
few
soon.
Minutes or so. Yeah. Although, YouTube Live is pretty cool because I believe we can stream as long as we want.
I've seen people stream for days.
Okay.
So action points. Let's talk
personal preps.
Let's talk personal preps, and
I
probably not
mindset.
In future. Yeah, mindset.
Let's just talk
but what
mindset.
We're what we're doing right now, and what we're.
But I do want to talk about masks, because I know a ton of people have been having questions about masks.
Yeah, but
okay. Let's talk about the other stuff
first. Is mindset. We can come back and we can talk about
sure.
more detailed stuff if people want. But the main mindset I think we need people to be thinking about is don't panic. Don't fall prey to a whole bunch of different conspiracy theories.
Right.
There's more conspiracy theories floating around the internet right now. Do your research. Actually study things out. Find right. people who are genuinely knowledgeable, not just random Twitter dudes. And but really be thinking about how you can help other people. What you can be doing to lessen the impact of these disruptions. So
right.
whether that comes from making sure that you have enough supplies that you can help your neighbors, making sure that you're not taking so many supplies out of the stores that people are going to not have them.
Especially when it's stuff you don't need.
Especially when it's stuff that you don't need. These are all really important things for us to think about. Not just in terms of what's happening today, but just kind of in general. And again, this virus is revealing weaknesses.
Yeah.
This is a good thing. It's a good thing for us to be aware of our weaknesses and try to figure out how to fix them. But in order to do that, we have to be very careful about how we think through these things and not just say one of the weaknesses is capitalism because it allows price gouging. It's time to bring the government in and they can fix stuff. Or, well, the government allowed this to happen, so now it's time to get rid of it. Now, that one is not a terrible idea, but let's not go overboard and say it's time for us to start shooting all the politicians. That may actually happen in certain parts of the world, but this is something where we need to be very cautious and careful and get all the info. and really think through the ways that we can find the silver linings. There are opportunities here to fix major problems that are affecting this and other countries. We can see the problems very clearly now. We actually have some hard work to fix them. But that's something that we could actually do in the future.
Right. So, in summary, as far as I would believe, a very simple action point, because I know a lot of folks want exacts. They want, like, do this, don't do this. They want formulas. I would say one of the big ones right now, obviously mindset is a big part of it, is there's, unless you have an absolute reason to go somewhere or leave somewhere, there's an, just don't go out. You're not necessarily going to be helping things, spreading it around. What we want to do is, you know, obviously get through this and kill this off. Social distancing is a thing. It can work, even though some folks out there saying, no, it doesn't work. And it's, yeah, well, it doesn't work if people don't actually do it. But if you do it, it actually does work. So I'd say one of the easiest and biggest action points out there is, unless you have a very specific reason to go somewhere, then don't go. Maybe stay at home a little bit more and open a book. I know I don't read enough, but there is this thing called books, and they open up and you flip the pages manually. You don't use your thumbs. So perhaps you could do that, or maybe you could catch up on some documentaries, or maybe you could spend time with your family. Maybe you don't realize that you have a family because you're constantly running around at work. I know that's something that I need to probably work on a little bit more, work less, be around people more. Although right now I can't be around people as much because of all this stuff going on. But that's a very easy action point, I believe, for people. Like, there's no reason necessarily to, you know, go to movie theaters and watch movies. There's tons of movies on Netflix, some of these other, you know, platforms out there. I'm just waiting for one company to take all of them and basically recreate cable, but we'll see when that happens. So that's probably one of the simplest action points out there. You know, keep a level head. Don't just look for people to tell you what to do. I mean, obviously you guys can come here and go, T-Rex, what are you guys doing? I just want to do exactly what you're doing. That's not necessarily the best idea. You should really think for yourself, study what's going on. You can see what we're doing. You can see what these other folks are doing. You can read all the countless emails you're probably getting from, you know, Marriott and Southwest, these companies listing, like, we're still taking care of you. We're still cleaning. But gather all that information to come up with your own personal SOPs and what you're actually going to do over the next few weeks, months, whatever, however long this is. And we'll just see what happens. So, until later, this is Lucas, Isaac, David from T-Rex Arms, and we will catch you guys around on a live again, hopefully sometime soon.
Yeah, so thanks for sticking around for this experiment. We'll see what we do.